And when people say they don't know, is the official, people desire official recognition. Mm. So there's power. When you talk about, I'm thinking of that, that a national apology makes it official. And I think it makes people feel like it's now okay to address, right, what happened. If it's now also, it's being seen. And it's also, I think, part of that culture of how do you make Matabeleland feel like we're part of Zimbabwe? It's that thing of a lack of apology means a lack of being recognized, a lack of your issues, what matters to you being brought into the national dialogue, right? Now in Zim, of course, we know it's problematic because how can, how can you have your cake and eat it? How, who
will apologize?
Yes, who will apologize? And as Nat was saying at the beginning,
Chick, you really make the best charlotte oxtail.
Yeah,
you like it. Thank you. Thank
you. You like it. You like it.
Guys, I'm good at a lot of things.
You are ready to be a wife.
I'm ready.
And I'm very multi-talented.
You are very, very multi-talented. Thank you so
much. I'm good at all things.
It is just what I needed. You know, obviously, you know, coming from America.
Oh, God. That's America. America.
How's, I paid for that flight. You guys will learn.
So did
every time you'd be like, yeah, that time when I was in America.
God, God help us. God have mercy on our souls.
But I missed you.
I missed you too. How was it? How was it?
Oh my God, it was absolutely awesome.
Was it awesome?
It was awesome.
Like, why didn't you come back with an American accent?
Girl, this is an American accent. What
do you,
you
know, if I had gone to America, like even if it was just for like 24 hours, I would have come back speaking American. Like, I am not joking.
Really?
I would have been like, so guys, I am, I traveled to America. I flew first class. I was having champagne and, you know, the weather was amazing.
Yeah.
But I decided to come back to Britain because, you know what, Brexit is real.
Oh, Brexit is so real.
I have to come and monitor the situation.
Yeah. I mean, I am here to report that Brexit is absolutely real.
Like, right.
Literally everything, the economy, the men
have Brexited
out of the UK.
Oh my God, it's like relationships dolo low.
Exactly. Like, oh my God.
Oh my God.
But you know what? All I will say is God bless America.
Dolo-lo. So you had a good vacation.
Yeah, and shout out to all the people who, you know, took pictures of me and videos.
So when I put my piece up, I'm a hat. It will swim. But anyway,
we move on. But yes, Golly, I missed you. Episode 8.
Episode number 8.
Woo, woo, woo. Girl in Skies Girl podcast. In Skies. With me, Natasha.
And Golly.
And I sometimes go by Nat.
I sometimes go by Michelle.
Yes, Michelle. What's up? What's up?
What's been happening, man? What's been happening?
Man, first of all, thank you so much. Like, I spent this whole weekend with you. It has been a pleasure.
You spent quite a good part of this week.
Yeah.
Together.
You know, when I came back, like, I was like, you know, like you have the holiday blues and you're like, oh my God, I don't want to be back. And then Golly was like, girl, we got to prepare for this episode and everything. But I'm glad to be back. And then you hosted a marvelous thing with your famous Tshwala and oxtail.
I that's what I enjoy. I love cooking for people. I love having people around. I just get such pleasure from just creating that space, having people talking about things. I really enjoy it. So I do it out of love. It's food with love.
Yes.
But yes, should we have a look at Episode number seven.
Yes, so episode number 7, which was Show Some Respect, Scafiana.
Show Some Respect, Scafiana.
Like, I cackled. Do you know what you Scafiana? You better show some respect, Scafiana. Show some respect, Scafiana.
Show some respect, Scafiana. Show some respect,
Scafiana. So that episode, we talked about apology languages. We were talking about how we give apologies, how we receive apologies. And Golly and I just had a conversation around that, and we touched on sort of like national apologies, what the function of a national apology is. And I think I say this to you, and I say this to quite a few people, that it really was my favorite episode.
You did.
I think for me, it was like the episode that you know, I said, like, for you and I think we had such honest conversation pre the episode, on the episode, post the episode.
Yeah.
Just about learning more about each other. And it definitely is an episode that I'll look back and I'll be like, when we're not doing episode 100, I'll be like, this episode was it. So, guys, if you have not listened to it, please definitely go back and listen to episode 7. But were there any comments that stood out to you?
Yeah, so I have a comment from Matt. Sorry, guys, my handles. At Matt_Tida, who says, your last podcast was so deep for me. Someone expected an apology from me recently, which I didn't think they deserved. Maybe I need to debate the deed and my newspaper need to get out of the gridlock.
and then one from me was, speaking of apologies with Gellin's guys, I've been to a few predominantly black church services where a random white dude kneels in front of everyone and apologizes for slavery and colonization. Cringe fest. Sorry. And then what? This is from Tuli Kinging. Another one from me, from @DesireeMoyo, says, Gellin's guys, at a national level, an apology sets the stage for reparations. An apology at national level without reparations is just a means of silencing the afflicted.
At Ness_X says, because sometimes people say sorry for the sake of it. I want someone to demonstrate that they understand how they have hurt or wronged me, to take ownership. I shouldn't have spoken to you like that. Please accept my apologies, etc. And also Elaine at Elaine T, who says, it is important for people to admit responsibility and express remorse for me. Interesting topic. I enjoyed listening. #girlinstars.
And then Wenko C quoted and said, a child who's not taught how to apologize can't become a leader who tells people to debate
around. Oh, right. Quotes, should we quote the original?
I mean, I wasn't going to quote myself.
I really was hoping you'd come in at this point. All right.
Quotes in brackets, Harvard referencing, it's Fuyane, comma, 2019. And then we have the MCM, who says, at my levels, they are multifaceted. I really related with the restitution part. Saying sorry isn't enough, and this is genuine, and there is action for me. I need to know you understood why you're apologizing. Anything else, still a low.
And then from Olga Pumbasela, she was like, this week's episode was heavy, hey? Very thought-provoking. I also love the contrast with the previous one. Lol, they've switched up on us. Gellin's guys, you're doing great, honestly. Thank you so much. And you guys, just look at the hashtag Gellin's guys on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, to see what everyone else is saying.
So did Olga Pumbasela say that they switched it up on us?
Level up.
So she said that we switched it up on the last episode.
You are switching on and off. Switch.
What is she saying?
Yeah, switching.
Then someone told me that we're multi what?
Multifaceted.
People know English.
Yay.
Followers know English.
Yay.
They are learned.
Our learned fellows.
So we have like a super special guest. Do you remember when I told you that we had booked her?
Chick.
You're in America.
I was in America living my best life.
You couldn't even be here to hold my hand.
I was in America living my best life. And then I got a message from God. She was like, girl, guess who is coming on the podcast?
What time was that?
It was like midnight your time. And I was like, you were like, guess who's coming on the podcast?
I was like Vuga, Natasha.
I was super excited.
It was
excited.
Just like, it's not just anybody that we have. We literally have, I'm just going to tell you a few things about her.
Yeah.
It's a her, for starters.
Mm-hmm.
She's a winner of Stanford's Fiction with a Sense of Place.
Mm-hmm.
She's been featured in Oprah's top 10 titles to pick up now.
Please, stop there. Oprah Winfrey.
Oh, not to Oprah. Sorry.
Not Oprah.
Accents.
Not Oprah Fuyan. Oprah Winfrey. My aunt.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you're so auntie. Mm-hmm. Right, okay. Shortlisted for 2019 Swansea University International Dylan Thomas Prize. So we are going to be keeping an eye on that because the results are going to be announced shortly.
We're speaking it into being, yes. It is ours.
Yes.
We're bringing it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Her work has been recommended by the New York Times, The Guardian, Prestige, and Vanity Fair. Mm-hmm. In 2014, she was awarded the Herman Charles Bosman for the best literary work.
Mm-hmm.
She's been long listed for the 2019 Rathbones Folio Prize.
Mm-hmm.
These are not small things, guys.
Not small things. Oh.
It's not small things.
And this is just a few.
Just a few things.
A few that we took.
Do you know what I mean?
And. She is one of Queen Lozi K's wildest dreams.
Say that again, sister.
One of Queen Lozi K's wildest dreams.
Mm?
One of the top niggas wempoop.
Yes, the top.
And most important.
Upper echelon.
Upper. Exactly. Niggas wempoop. Gold membership. Black card. Niggas wempoop.
Yes.
And most importantly, our friend. She's the author of House of Stone, Novuyo Rosa Tshuma.
As I've been sitting here listening to you two and just laughing. It's so exciting to be here. I'm so honored to be here. You know, when I was here last year, mm-hmm. and you guys were talking about this. You were talking about this podcast that you want to start. And when you started Girl in Skies, I'm like, oh my goodness, those are my friends. They are doing the things, doing that needs to be done. You know, excited to be sitting here with you guys.
Listen, you couldn't be more excited than we are. We have been waiting for this moment. It's honestly...
Mm-hmm.
It's such an honor to have you, and thank you for gracing us today with your presence.
Oh.
It's really, we are so excited. We're really looking for, we look forward to all the episodes, obviously, but we're really looking forward to having this one-on-one with you. How are you?
Oh my goodness. You know, after that oxtail that I had last night, Xolie, honestly, your food, yes, that's the best meal I've had, home-cooked meal I've had in a while. Thank you so much. So after that, I'm on top, tip-top form.
Oh, that's good. And like I said, you know, it's all out of love. You know, I love spending time with you guys, and it's always such... You know, it's always such good energy. And I'm even reminded the last time when we met you or when we saw you and you'd invited us to the pub, the dinner with your publishers.
Oh,
and it was Nat and I, it was Uhosi Ubutholezwe Nyathi, who has now just been, he's been promoted to the regional director.
Arts Gallery.
Yes. You know, and it was just literally that dinner was the pinnacle of our summer because there was so much that happened in that summer. There's so much, we spent so much time together. If you remember as well, it was the time post
AMA elections.
Mm-hmm. We shared our hopes and dreams of a new Zimbabwe. We shared our lows when we were thinking about how crushed we were that we as Zimbabweans could not even have like our dreams were shattered. They were literally shattered. I remember I just felt so forlorn. I felt so miserable. I felt so unhappy. But we created such a space and we had such conversations. We had such deep, meaningful conversations. And that in essence was when we thought about these conversations should be recorded. They should be recorded for future purposes because you know what? It is important because we cannot be silenced anymore. Our feelings matter. You know, our feelings are valid. The way that we are feeling right now, and because it was common, it was common amongst us. We felt that, you know, there's people in America, there's people in South Africa, there's people who are outside Zimbabwe, Zimbabweans outside Zimbabwe who are feeling the exact same way. And we're like, we should do this pod. And then it's just to see you traveling the world. You are forever here, there, and everywhere. You've been in Nigeria, you've been in Berlin, you're going to Sweden. You know, it just makes us so proud. You have instilled such a sense of Zim proud. Is that a word? Zim pride in us. You know, I feel like there is something about the power of association. When we sat in that, you know, whether it was at King's Cross when we met with our drinks.
Can I just say that was my highlight? Because we were so, we were so crushed, right?
We were very
that
crushed.
There was not going to be a new Zimbabwe. And, you know, someone can look back and say, oh, you were naive to think so.
Yeah.
And I think we used that space to talk our, like, frustrations.
Yes.
And our dreams.
Yes. And, like, how we felt as being sort of, like, in the diaspora. And we used that time to kind of visualize, okay, guys, if this, you know, if ZANU PF won't let us be great, how can we be great?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there was this power, you know, when you're talking, I felt enthusiasm. I mean, my heart was just gladdened. I remember that last dinner with my publishers, because they said, you can come with anyone. And I could not have thought of better people, because we'd spent the summer together. And it'd been such an inspiring and exciting time for me. You ladies, you remind me of the best of home. So for me, that was... I felt at home. You're so welcoming and so inspiring and so uplifting. And I love what you've just said, that the idea of being naive, the power to dream, is what I think brought us all in our respective spaces. Slaying. I have a girl in skies. You know, we needed this for Bulawayo, for Zimbabwe, for women, for men, for young people like us.
Yeah.
And it's amazing that you guys went out there and did the thing.
Yeah. I mean, it was literally that summer. I mean, just to really highlight that summer, we spoke about so much, so many things as young Zimbabweans. We discussed our futures. We discussed our formative years and how they've shaped us into being the people we are today. So really, it was that space that birthed the idea that, you know what, let's do this. Let's put things down to paper. And it's just amazing. Like, I feel like we've, in a way, we've come full circle. You're sitting here on our pod. Wow. We said, the last time we saw you, even to your publishers.
We talked, like, remember, Xolie, you say to the publisher, what did you say?
I was like, we are going to be having this girl on our pod. We hadn't done anything at that point, but we spoke it into being.
In existence.
And Uhwasi was also just kind of finishing up, wrapping up on his MSc, or his master's. Sorry, I don't know if it's MA or MA. Messy, but he was just finishing up on his master's. He's gone home and he's really put what he has, you know, learnt into practice. You are just absolutely amazing. Like, oh, you know, we were proud of you this time. Was it close to a year ago this time? We were proud of you then, and, you know, even more so now.
Studio.
No, thank you. Thank you for your wisdom. And thank you for being who you are.
No, thank you, guys. It's possible. Teamwork, energy. I like the idea of energy and flow, like what you're talking about. It flows. And there are all these, I think, behind even every sort of successful venture, even the idea of the novel or what's happening, there are all these connections and relationships happening in the background. And for me, it's such a pleasure to have one, at least one of that set of relationships out here now playing itself out.
Well, we normally have a time for politics. So Nat's going to hand over to you just to...
For the politics.
For politics. So politics.
I feel like it's been really slow on the politics front. But interestingly enough, I think... Today, this week, the government of Zimbabwe has started what they're calling the national dialogue. National dialogue. I mean, come on, guys. How many dialogues have we had? And we still have, you know, the August violence. You know, still unanswered for. And
January shutdown.
January shutdown.
Pending.
When things happen, pending, right? So much national dialogue. You know, like, I think
the only dialogue that's moving forward, I'm a white farmer.
Exactly. And you know, like, they started this the National Peace Reconciliation Commission, which has been a farce, to be honest with you. And I think it just ties in nicely with what we're talking about the, you know, the national apology, Gukurahundi, and hopefully what we'll touch on in this episode as well. But that's really the thing that I wanted to sort of highlight, that it's a farce, right? National dialogue. If you're going to be sincere about national dialogue, you have to name what it is that we're dialoguing, right?
Certainly you can't be selective.
You cannot be selective. This cannot be just a beauty pageant, right?
Which is exactly
that
what
you're
it is.
Trying to do in front of the West and stuff like that. You
bring
lost
lipstick on
people.
A pig's mouth.
Exactly. Lipstick on a pig's mouth is still a pig, right? So that's that. You can tell that I'm a Maya. And then we mentioned this, but then I wanted to touch on Uti. We have a new regional director for the National Art Gallery. my friend Uchosi.
Yes, proud to know him, claim him.
Yeah. And so he's taken up that post. I think it's been really interesting to see the response that that has received.
Uh-huh. It has.
I think it's been, I think much more than probably even he expected. Mm. And I think that goes to show that people are yearning for space for young leadership. Mm. And I say young, but you know, like we're in our 30s, guys. Do you know what I mean? Like in
other countries, I don't know about you.
But what I'm saying, obviously. I'm joking, but what I'm saying is in other countries, people in their 20s and stuff like that, like they're getting those. But in Zimbabwe, there's this whole there's this whole ZANPF thinking at all levels, right, where you know people wait for their turn, you know, to get their things exactly. People in there, so it was actually like a, you know, when he told us that, right, that he got that post, I was like, this has you like written all over it. You know, you've been preparing for this. So I wanted to highlight that.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm hoping to do, if this Brexit technology allows, let us see. I want to try and do something.
And I love that he made the Sunday news. Big splash.
Right.
On his first day at work.
Yeah. So we're going to try and call him. I don't know. I hope it will work.
Yeah, Tandy would. And I remember him from the British Council days.
Hi, Mr. Director.
Richard.
You are speaking to Gerlin Sky's podcast. Original director.
Yes. Yeah.
Honorable. Yeah, honorable. Honorable, sir. Your Excellency.
It's not a political office.
Wow.
I'm a parastatal employee.
Yeah. Wow. No. Humility as well.
Yeah. No, so we just wanted to say, so we've got Uchosi Buto Nyati. I guess depends on who he's talking to. Sometimes he's Xhosa, sometimes he's Vuto. But wanted to first of all say congratulations from us and Gerlin Skies for
your
appointment as the regional director of the National Art Gallery in Bulawayo. And yeah, just how are you feeling about it? And can you tell us a little bit more about what that actually means? You know, what you're doing? Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you very much for the congratulatory message. Greetings to your colleague, Nat Xolie.
Yes.
It reminds me of my days in London.
Yes.
But back to the subject matter. Yeah. Well, for me, of course, it's an exciting challenge coming particularly so after my return from the UK, where I spent the whole of 2017 and 2018 starting towards an MA, Culture, Policy and Management, and assuming this leadership responsibility, it immediately put my qualifications, practice and experience into test. So I'm looking forward indeed to steering the galleries into the heights in the next few years and assessing our authority as a leading cultural institution in as far as visual expression is concerned. It's a big responsibility. Significant move from where I was all along, Amakuku International Heritage Center.
Mm-hmm.
But all the same, I think my cumulative experience, qualifications, and networks will come in handy in providing the kind of leadership that is expected. So, yes, I'm excited, and I'm also alive to the challenges that are facing me. Mm-hmm. But all the same, we will do best.
Okay, no, thank you for that. And I think for us, you know, for people who have never engaged with the National Art Gallery and specifically, say, for people in the diaspora, do you want us to engage with you? If so, how?
Well, if you understand the language that government is now talking, they are talking the language of engagement and re-engagement. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that countries in Africa have done in the diaspora is to tap into their diaspora dividends. That's a common expression that you and I referred to during my time in London. But there is no way Zimbabwe can tell its national story without the active participation of its citizens scattered across the world. Countries like Nigeria, Ghana have done that. Zimbabwe is still very much lacking in that regard. So certainly, in my scheme of things, diaspora engagement is very important and pertinent to the extent that the diaspora, beyond purchasing artworks locally for export, they are the people who should then convey the Zimbabwean narrative. Art is subjective, ultimately. When you buy a piece of art, it's subjective, open to multiple interpretations. But it is the personal testimonies that people in the diaspora, like yourselves, say that sells the Zimbabwean story, ultimately. If you speak positively, then it means the Zimbabwean image benefits in that way. So art on its own is not complete. The narrative demands the human voice, and that human voice is the voice of people like you through platforms such as Genocide.
Thank you so much. I mean, before we end this call, is there anything else that you wanted to share with our listeners? Maybe, first of all, how can they engage or follow the National Art Gallery? Can you give us handles, details, and all that?
Yes, we have a strong social media presence because we understand the way that we now live in. So we have a Facebook page, National Gallery of Zimbabwe in Bulawayo. We have a Twitter account, BYO Gallery. We also have a website, nationalgallerybyo.com. So subscribe to those channels and follow the work that we do. If you have ideas on how the gallery can be of service to people in Zimbabwe and in the diaspora, give me a shout out on Twitter, Khosi Nyati, K-G-O-S-I Nyati. That's my Twitter handle. So we are ready to do business with people with ideas and the energy and the kind of futuristic outlook, you know, so that Zimbabwe rejoins the community of nations.
No, thank you so much. That was such a great conversation. Thank you, Foss, and we're wishing you all the best.
But I did not hear Novuyo's voice.
I wanted to talk about, you know, seeing where you've come from those 12 years ago at British Council, Buto. It's just inspiring and amazing. From when you led that project to British Council, that got me my first publication. And here I am now. Yeah. You're doing your thing. I'm here with these ladies. It's full circle. And so proud of you, Buto.
Yeah.
And Yazi.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yazi voice. Please, really
you
voice.
You have to say something.
Just to say well done. You know, it's we were just saying earlier, you probably listened to this after, but we were just saying how the power of association, how that summer of 2018, what it meant, and, you know, how we are seeing the results of it in 2019. And we are so proud of you, you know, putting us on the mark, you know, somebody that we know. We are really proud of you and wishing you all the very best in the future.
Wonderful. I look forward to a day when you come down and do one of your episodes from the gallery space.
It will happen.
Thank you so much.
Straight from your lips.
Wonderful.
Thank you. We're holding you to it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And thank you to you. Thank you. Bye.
Wonderful. Bye. Sure.
I think what he just said about Zoom and futuristic outlook, it's so powerful. It's so powerful, so important. That positive, home is a positive space. Outside of what we're talking about, outside of ZANU. Like reclaiming Zimbabwe outside of that politicized space, right? Where other things can happen and grow.
No, home is a special place for us, you know, in so many ways. And it will forever be... it will forever be that for us and in our hearts. And, you know, there's a lot about how our formative years have shaped us into who we are today. I'm curious as to how, and I'm probably naive as well, how a young person in Zimbabwe is nurtured in writing. We had a bit of a discussion about this yesterday and we talked about, you know, is it the element of you, and I wasn't surprised that you went to a private school in Zimbabwe. I mean, am I right in saying that there is more of a tendency to push creative arts in private schools rather than in public schools? And how would you encourage a young writer who is probably not getting the support, be it from their parents or be it from their school, in their right to pursue writing?
No, I loved what you just said. Oh, the idea of being naive is how I actually got into writing, asking questions because you get these interesting answers. Yes, I remember we were talking about it. I think definitely EGC had something to do with it, sadly, or otherwise. you know, private school debate recently on Twitter, if you remember. But yeah, it was a wholesome education. Very much sports, very much the arts, and also academic, very mixed. Whether it's music, whether it's writing. And I was very much into public speaking, Toastmasters, Amnesty International, those sort of things. And writing was, I got the sense that it was something that I could try and do.
Mm-hmm.
And I really loved books. And if you remember when we grew up, I think, you know, the time when we grew up as Zim was also a very positive time generally. We had a public library, Bulayo. I was always there. Also, it was before this Twitter stuff anyway.
Yeah.
At Vele Scholar, you just go to the public library, get a book.
Yeah,
there were the books at schools. I don't know. So for me, I think that environment also, Zim as that environment, was quite nurturing in terms of reading. Because before I knew I would write, I loved to read. And many people.
Right.
But definitely the writing, I think that confidence came from that environment. And also when I saw Chimamanda on TV. Then I met Ubuntu at British Council for this writing project. So tapping into those sort of opportunities. It's interesting you talk about young writers in Zim. I guess I can preempt. There's a project I'm actually currently putting together.
Okay.
I'll be looking to do a series of workshops as later on in the probably not December.
Okay.
Targeted specifically at young people.
Okay.
Because when I went even what December, that was the biggest question. Like young writers, how to start, where to start. And I think just being in that environment, where we gather, because that was very nurturing for me when I went to Chimamanda's workshop in Farafina. So there's something in the works, some small thing I thought I could do and put together at home.
That's interesting. But can we walk back a little bit, right, to Xolie's question of a young person in Zim, right? And you alluded to the fact that, you know, maybe like being in an environment like HGC helped, right? I kind of want to get a picture of the timeline, right?
Okay.
In the sense that at school, was writing fostered? Like, did when you're in form, whatever, from grade one, was it, did you know Uti writing is a skill? Like, was there a teacher who was like, you're a good writer?
Yeah.
Like, I just want to get that timeline.
I love that. You know, I guess I was always good I remember when I was 8 years old, this is a primary school, SOS Herman Minor.
Okay. You
know, I was already taking books from the 12-year-old section.
Oh, really?
And so our teachers were encouraged, that sort of thing. And then I was in grade four, my teacher wanted me to skip a grade. My mother's a teacher and she refused. She said it would mess up my development. So I think Philip, my English teachers specifically were helpful. Then in high school, HEC, I'm remembering, I've forgotten her name, this white English teacher who used to act on Broadway in her younger days. She was very encouraging to me in my writing. So I had just confidence. And then what I used to do is, at break time, when others were playing, I would be writing my books. And so the other kids would come and like, what are you doing? You know, they were pretty mean about it though. That was an interesting stage. But my teachers, I had a teacher who read that. It was my maths teacher. Then he's like, oh wow, you should try and get this published. That's when I think the seed, I was young.
Right.
Was planted. Said it in passing and moved on. And that for me was when the seed was planted. I hope, does that help?
Yeah. Too? And then so, that was so school. And then British Council, how old are you?
I was 19. So by then I'd written, I wrote a novel.
Mm.
But the thing is, because of the books, you know, we read, did you guys read on Nancy Drew?
Yes.
Or Dean Koontz.
Yes.
Or Robert Ludlum or John Grisham. So that's what we read in high school. So I had written an action-packed novel that was set in Paris, London, and I tried to get it published. Actually, Ama Books go Bulayo.
Right.
And I actually sent it. I typed it, I sent it, and then Ama Books wrote back and they're like, you know, maybe as a movie this will work. But we appreciate the imagination, right. But I'm a high speed chaser, and it was, you know, maybe impractical.
Right.
And then they referred me to British Council, and I remember. So I remember the day I went and I met Ubuntu, and I went, I'm like, I have this project and I want to write. And that's when Ubuntu told me about, oh, this is what we're doing at British Council. That's how I actually got to join the British Council.
Right, right.
And when I went there, the writing flourished. We had AMA workshops like Chris Mlalazi, Christopher Mlalazi.
Oh, wow.
And then I got to represent the project at the end of that year. Mm. It was part of a Southern African regional project. So we went to Lusaka and I was nominated to go and talk on behalf of the project. And that's when...
At 19?
Yes.
Wow.
And that's when it started. So it was a young people's anthology between 12 years of age to 25.
Mm.
And that was my first sort of foray into that. And then I saw that year, 19, I saw Chimamanda on BBC Hard Talk Extra.
Wow.
So that those are the links. So that's when I'm like, you know, so I moved from writing about these high-speed chases. So I saw there's an African woman, a young woman, contemporary. I know Chinua, I respect her, Chinua, but they always felt ancient. Who's writing? So that inspired me. So I wrote to her. Then she sent me a signed copy of her book.
Oh, wow.
To Novuyo, with the hope that you will keep reading and writing. You can imagine what that did for me.
Yeah.
It became a big thing for me, a gesture, and I became determined to find my way in writing. So those have been the steps.
Nice.
I like how you slowed me down to really get into the specifics of how things worked.
And what was like what was your family like when you were telling them about your passions and your dreams?
You know,
because these are not, writing is not something that is really encourage me to be a lawyer, a doctor. Do you know what I mean?
You can even imagine, was that time during my shortage, you know, I'm probably a short time, likely future. At least, you know, my parents were, my mother, my family was understandably worried.
Right.
Because I was young and very unreasonable in my passion. Like I really loved writing. And once I saw Chimamanda, I was determined that there must be a way that I can make writing an important part of my life. But I couldn't answer the question of how. And I started studying architecture in NUST for one semester.
Oh, wow.
I quit. I quit before the semester was over, but I knew my mother wouldn't let me, so I didn't tell her. So for 2 weeks, I pretended to be going to school. And I would go internet cafe. I'd struck a deal with the guys and I'd just be typing, writing. So very naive, but determined. And I remember when my family found out, they called a family meeting, understandably. But it was concern, right? Imagine you're in Zoom and you're asking, okay, how are you going to do this? Because that's what they asked me. I couldn't answer. There's no path that you can see as Zoom. So there were ups and downs where I tried writing. I had some successes, like for British Council. But I sent work out a lot, and initially a lot of fail, a lot of rejection. And that's when I did my economics degree.
Right.
In South. Now, when I was in South Africa, what I really did was to send my work out to competition. So I have short stories, about 11 short stories published in anthologies on the continent, online and in. And so that encouraged me that, I keep sending work out and it keeps being published. And then I tried to get a collection. And I'm happy you guys are walking me through. It's good for young writers to know that journey. Because when people think you've succeeded, they think you just woke up. I tried to publish a collection of short stories as them and I failed. And the Weaver Press published, she was great. She was really great. I was like, you need to start a blog. No one knows you. Now, I started that blog, and that blog put me in touch with No Violet Live.
Wow.
Wow.
She found the blog. Wow. She just started writing to me. I was wondering, it was before she even published We Need Your Names, before she won the cane. We just started talking. And she just took an interest in my work. And she was like, you're really talented.
Amazing.
Send me your writing and let me look. And she'd read my work and give me feedback. Wow. Just like that.
Wow.
And she was now key. Can you see what's happening? She was key, because when I finished my economics degree and I was frustrated, I'm like, I want to write, but I know I'm on the wrong path. I'm not interested in this career, but I don't know how to get from here to
there. Yeah.
And then she said, apply for AMA Masters in Fine Arts Creative Writing. I've never heard of them.
Wow.
And she's so awesome because she doesn't spoon feed you. So I was like, what's that? She's like, no, Google. I think her mantra was, if you're interested in something, you'll find out. So I went, I found out. She helped me through the application process. She paid. I had no money in the South. She paid for my application fees. This is the writer, Novuyo Rosa Tshuma. She's been my mentor and sister. Then I happened to get into Iowa. Shock of shocks. It's the top program in the US. 3% acceptance rate.
Wow.
mina nginjenje, I got it. So that was a turning point.
Mm.
And again, it was Novuyo who helped me get there. She helped me settle down there. And from then on, when I was in the States, mm-hmm. opportunities opened. I had mm-hmm. now access to writing community, publishers, editors.
Mm-hmm.
Again, that journey we were talking, I was telling you guys, that journey was mm-hmm. difficult because mm-hmm. you are unknown. And initially, publishers weren't really skeptical about House of Stone as a book.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing to me to be sitting in and to have had this amazing year because mm-hmm. I really had no expectations for the
mm-hmm.
book.
Mm. It took you 6 years to write House of Stone. Can you take us back to day one when you literally, I don't know, are you a pen with paper girl? Are you on your laptop? Are you like, where are you? Can you take us back to that moment?
You know, before I even started the 6 years, the first as a night, I was 23.
Mm-hmm. And
I had no idea what I was doing, which is, I think, partly why I did it. I was just very curious. So it was like an expedition. Sort of try and find out, whoa, you know, anger. I was in South Africa feeling unwelcome. Mm. So who are we as Zimbabweans? Why am I here? Why am I suffering? Why is home the way it is? Mm. And I just started asking questions, reading up, internet, books, anything I could find out. Then I started jotting down on my notes. That's how actually the book came to be.
Okay.
And I just started jotting down on my notes. And because writing was just my way, things I always did.
Yes.
So that's how it started slow. I didn't have the big idea when I started. Mm. It grew gradually. Mm.
Okay, interesting. I love how you build characters, your characters in your book. The lead, Uzamani, is like, we've spoken about Zamani. Like,
oh, yeah. He's,
like, you know, he could almost come and take a seat in this very room because I feel he's so real.
Mm.
I feel like I have, when you read about him, you are taken through a journey of highs and lows.
Mm.
You know, there's a point in the book where I think, oh my God, like this guy, you know, I loathe him. And then there's, you take me a few pages later where I'm like, oh my God, this guy, you know? So how does, what themes like did you want to bring out? Because I get like, all I get from this is that he's not all I get, but what I get is that he wants to belong. You know, I'm even taken to the scene where he sees a black Jesus walking. I don't want to give too much away in the book, but he sees a black Jesus walking and he's with his son and how he longs to, you know, he goes there with the intention of wanting to hurt him, but then he longs to be that little boy.
Mm.
He sees himself in that little boy.
Mm.
So there's just, but how do you get accepted in a society that is constantly rejecting you?
That's such a powerful question. I mean, you're talking. Mm-hmm. I have a friend who read House of Stone and was like, Uzamani, at some point, they're like, I hate you, Uzamani.
Yeah.
He was shouting at the book.
I'm like,
that's good. We're feeling something.
Mm.
You know, the feeling of belonging, Uzamani, and it's interesting. It's something I had not thought of as I was writing, but it came. Growing up in Matabele land, when I never felt a part of Zimbabwe, you know, in a welcome, you know, where I think we've always been looking out.
Mm.
Whether it's South African culture. I mean, some of the music, it's already there blasting. and just for me, it was also that collective belonging, I think, trying to be expressed through this character of not feeling safe or part of a place.
Right.
For whatever reasons.
Right.
And in this case, of course, it's tied to Gukurahundi, it's tied to history.
Yes.
I'm trying to figure out why. And it's so visceral, right? Belonging. And I think also of Zamani, someone who's starved of love. But really starved of love, Augustrias. And for me, it also reminds me also of maybe the 2000s when we were... So, you know, when there were food shortages, the lengths which people would go to get food, if you can think of those parallels, because Uzamani, you know, he was really, he was, some parts of him, I enjoyed writing it, but sometimes it was really taxing because his desire for love is so desperate,
yes.
It gets unhealthy.
Yes.
And it's that relationship.
Yes.
Or at some point you hate him because it's like, what is he doing?
Yeah.
And at some point you're shocked by Uchi.
It, in a way, you almost kind of give, His story kind of gives you that it's like, it's okay, you know. Do you know? And I felt uncomfortable with that.
Mm-hmm.
I felt uncomfortable with myself. But then I was like, no, come on. You know, in my head, it's like I'm having a fight inside my head.
Yes.
And I'm like, no, you can't be saying that it's okay for him to be the person who he is because of what he's gone through. But it's interesting. Why did you choose Uzamani to kind of be the person to account the different stories and the different narratives that are in your book.
There's something so profound you've just said now, that just like that conflict of it's okay.
Mm.
And then, no, you can't say it's okay to do what you're doing because of what you've gone through. Very powerful, right? That's so profound. It's going to stay with me. Thank you for that insight. Uzamani, for me, he was able to be honest, to encapsulate the turmoil, I think. The turmoil and, the difficulty, the horror, and maybe also the joys, because there's some points where Zamani is a bit joyful.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when he's getting love, no matter even if he's gotten it in the wrong way.
Yeah.
Of our history, you know, and not just the Gukurahundi. If you, when you read up about Zimbabwe's history, we are people who are resilient, we've been loving.
Mm.
And just think of our families growing up, but we've also had a very violent history.
Yeah.
You know, reading our history, then it hit me when I was looking at my mother, which when she was a teenager, this woman, the liberation war was going on. In her early 20s, Gukurahundi was going
happening.
On.
Yeah.
But here she is. And of course, there's latent stuff happening, latent trauma. But she's living a full life. Then, of course, the 2000s came. And that was heartbreaking for me to see. To be honest, my mother was a teacher. And to see her, hey, okay, that was hard. So it's these roller coaster moments. So for me, Zamani was able to capture that. Yes. And then to question. Because Zamani is someone who's very curious. He's also devious. He's also has a very deep interest in history. So for me, his eye could actually bring about that. At the same time, because it's a novel, he could keep the story interesting. It's almost like a detective thriller, psychological, because he's on a quest to find answers. Though the answers he finds are not necessarily answers he thought he would find. And then as we read the book, the life gets out of his control, which is for me also an experience of Zimbabwe, whether positive or negative. You know, things getting out of your control. Yes, you're trying to contain, it's spilling over. You find yourself in the UK, in America, you know, even if we're doing great things, the way we came here, at least the way it wasn't totally out of choice, it was also out of necessity. Yeah.
And I think Tandi is obviously, you portray her as such a strong woman. You know, and there's an element where you talk about how she, and you know, she encourages the reader to read upon, to know about Angela Davis, Queen Lozi K. But why was it important for you to kind of use women as, you know, and speak from them from such a point of strength?
I love that. Because Tandi was, you're such an intuitive reader, because that's exactly how I conceived Tandi. Yeah, the way you're speaking.
I hear.
No, the way she's speaking into the book, it's so amazing. First Zamani, now Tandi. You know, women have been underwritten in history. They've been underappreciated. And it's always a man's history. Even our liberation war, it's so tiring. Even reading our women's movements, the urban movements in Zimbabwe in the 60s, 70s, they were women strong. So I wanted to celebrate that. And especially when I came across the story of Queen Lozi K. I did not know that story until I started researching, which is heartbreaking. And Unet wrote that beautiful article on Queen Lozi K. You know, it's amazing. So for me, it was like, we need these. We also trying to say song of King Lobengula, but there was this woman, the strong, resilient woman. So it's a celebration. Me of womanhood, of strength, of bravery, of just women were beautiful creatures, were soft but also strong. We are sensual, but also we step up.
Yes.
No, so I think it's interesting that you mention Queen Lozi K, but I think before we go there, you touched on sort of like living in South Africa and that bit, right? I wanted to kind of go back there. Because before there was House of Stone, you've told us that there were blogs and stuff like that. But what I have read is Shadows.
Did you read Shadows?
Yes.
Yo.
Right. So Shadows was like, there's a novella and a collection of stories in there. And you actually won the 2014 award for this. Let me bring up what award it was.
Him and Charles Boseman Prize.
Yes. So I think it's really kind of really important for me to kind of give context that, you know, we are here talking about House of Stone, but there's just so much that has gone into it.
Oh,
what I really like about You know, when you talk about shadows, and for me, as someone who left Zim and I came straight to the UK, I think I'm very different because a lot of people have had a South African experience, which I have not had, right? And I like the way you tell the story, like about poor and like just that
poor one,
just that's like, you know, that experience of, you know, going to South Africa, like just I want to know from your point of view, how was it like being in South Africa for you, right? And just also, I guess, juxtaposing it to now you being in Iowa. And I think I'd just like to kind of get a sense from you how that South African experience, especially being Ndebele and feeling like we sort of
belong,
you know, you know, we can speak the language, you know, we are from there, like generations before, but that experience of like, being Zimbabwean.
So the highs and lows. I mean, first for me, SA was so, I remember the first day we got there, we'd been having shortages for so long in Zim. I got into it was a Pick and Pay. It was a Pick and Pay or ShopRite, and there was bread on the shelves. I remember staring at that bread and I had to stop myself from grabbing, going to hoard. That's a Zim thing because, you know, Zim. Hey, man, I'm like, oh, this bread will be here tomorrow. Don't. And I didn't. But SA was so exciting for me in its ambition, its breathy Joburg. But I learned that I was Zimbabwean in South Africa. Right. At home, you don't think is. And then Zimbabweans, as we were seeing there, it wasn't positive. We were illegal immigrants, whether or not you're legal. We were suffering. It was really a negative view. And it traumatized me for why I despised or disliked being associated, not to deny Zimbabwe, but that idea. Because I didn't see myself in that sense. And then I'm laughing because for a while I did pretend to be South African because it was just easier. You would hear Novuyo. It's like my South African friends, they just gravitate. And I remember I forged friendships with these lovely, lovely SA friends of mine. For 3 months, they did not know I was from Zim. They assumed I was from SA, and I let it go until I was to Guinea-Gupi. So it was a lunatam, I blam to Zimbabwe. But you know, it was that sense of there's the beauty, the power in belonging. Because like Novuyo, no, you're not Zimbabwean. So that lineage. At the same time, there was for me that sense of feeling really unwelcome and unwanted. So and it's interesting because Nasa's comment was a colonialism, borders drawn by the colonialists that is determining a passport versus our ethnic or right associations, which are equally as important. So it's interesting you asked that. But I mean, I came to if you now that you brought up the stories and shadows, they are traumatic, I think, some of them. And it's also, I think, that idea of also Goli. Remember when we left South Africa was also seen as this place in land of honey.
Land of milk and honey.
Then you go there and you see it's show was Salema Ketenin. Then you realize it's hard.
Yeah.
You know, so I had to also learn that. It was a growing experience, a learning experience. I'm a police at top, I'm an illegal immigrant. So, you know, they'd stop combis, the cops, and look. And the Nigerians were the easiest targets because they look West African. I was always passed over because I look South African. So those were the ways of
Yeah.
it. I hope that helps.
No, that's, I think that's interesting. And I think we talked about it in one of our previous episodes, which was, was it illusion of inclusion or being your whole self? We talked about Uti, how, for example, sometimes you meet people and the whole like pretending to be South African, right? And I think I used to look at it from a point of almost privilege in the sense that, like I'm saying, Uti, Mina, I came from Zim to the UK. I can't disown my Zimness, right?
That's what scared me, Iowa.
So
I couldn't hide. It freaked me out.
You were there.
You were from Zim, right?
And I'm exposed.
Yeah. I could never hide my zimness, right? Mm. So I always used to think, oh, people, then we talked about a story where there was a guy that we met here in UK and he was like, oh, he's South African. And then as we started talking, he starts talking about Mpopoma. But then, right, for years, I always used to look at that story and be like, oh, that guy. But then when I thought about it, I was like, it's actually a privilege. How can I say? It's almost like a there's a privilege to being able to be like, oh, I'm Zimbabwean. There's a privilege to being able to say I'm Zimbabwean when you're in South Africa. And it's it's mostly people who, what I'm saying, Ange, if you're coming from, if you're a minister's child in Zim, right? With money and everything, you go straight from Zim to whatever sent on apartment. Yes. Of course, you're gonna walk around and be like, "Yeah, I'm Zimbabwean." You know, whatever. I'm fine.
It's amazing.
So it's a preserve. Like for a long time, the proudly Zimbabwean tag, I think, was a preserve of the privilege. Right.
That is so powerful.
Where you couldn't. It's only now that I think was slowly through all this that we're doing and through people being tired of being like, I'm tired of hiding, you know, I think we're slowly being like, okay, we're proudly Zimbabwean, but people in South Africa, xenophobia, people are dying.
Yes, but that is so powerful.
Yeah. And at the same time, like, I mean, when you were talking, I remember the illusion of inclusion. Until that very last minute where you are actually, when people actually split hairs. So you're in South Africa and people are like, no, also Novuyo, but where exactly are you from? So that kind of follows us everywhere, even as Zimbabweans. You come to diaspora, wherever, and you can never be again your whole self. But then you are meant, you almost feel like you're a part of a community because, you know, you're black and there's other people there. But then people then will start classing you. How black are you? Are you black British? Are you black African? Are you black Caribbean? Do you know what I mean?
That is so powerful what you're saying, because another power, especially South Africa, maybe compared to, is you think, especially Ndebeles would think South Africa's home. Then you go there and you're rejected. It's that pain, right?
That pain of rejection. And I think it ties in because all of this is in part due to a lack of knowledge of history. Even on South Africa's part, which takes us back to House of Stone. Because House of Stone is a piece of history. Right. What House of Stone does is, I think, tell the Gukurahundi story in a grand way. I think in one of the grandest ways we have seen in Zimbabwe to date. It is a piece of history. Right. And it's sort of one of the books in my life, I can say, that has made such a great impact into how I think about the agency that I have for me. And basically what I have to do is Half of a Yellow Sun. Right.
I will. Inspiration right there.
By Chimamanda. Right. Where she tells the Biafra story again in a grand way. So that's why when you did the Biafra story, which is again a story in Nigeria, if you go there, it was silence. When I read it, I remember thinking this was like 2012, 13. I remember when I finished the book, I literally held that book and I was like, I need someone to tell this story about Gukurahundi.
Oh my God.
And I think it really changed the trajectory of me thinking about me. What is my agency? What is my social purpose? What can I do? Like social activism and everything, right? So then now we have House of Stone. And what I love about House of Stone, again, like I'm saying, it being a piece of history, to know from you is what gave you the agency, the audacity to feel like, okay, I'm sort of telling this story through fiction, history through fiction, right? If you could kind of talk me through, what was that thing that wouldn't let it go from you?
I was getting emotional listening to you talk. Thank you. Because books, so many books have done that for me. So to also even hear my book and other, you know, Chimamanda is mind blowing for me right now. So I'm getting tingles. I'm feeling goosebumps. So
Live in it. It's your moment, babe.
No. Oh, okay. Okay. Mm. Let me. Thank you. I'm just having moments here. No, this means a lot. Coming from you, you two, you know, as fellow women, Zimbabwean women, I respect, and you know, who've been there for me last time to hear, and also as Zimbabweans who are reading and saying this. Ooh, audacity. You know, because writing was my way of sort of, I think, thinking through things. To be honest, what really propelled even the writing of Gukurahundi as within that larger Zimbabwean history in the book was, you know, when you read up, when you sit with, especially Catholic Church, when you sit with those testimonies, as you just start feeling a chill. So, and it's not like I hadn't read them before. I think I had read them when I was younger as well, perused them. But I think it's also maybe being in a space to receive. I think it's really maybe not so easy to explain. Because it wasn't my first time reading those. But at that time when I was writing and sitting in those voices and hearing, it stirred up in me despair and anger, indignation, pain. Just a desire to now to tell it. Which, you know, how can... And I think having read like works like Chimamanda's Half of a Yellow Sun. There's a German book, The Tin Drum. It tells the story of the Holocaust by Günter Grass. It's, then you get to see how fiction or how stories have a power to narrate and shape these works. And I think I was inspired both as a reader, someone who loves books and is trying to emulate that in my own writing, to be honest. So I'd also give credit to books that have come before. Yvonne Vera, our own Zimbabwean, Stone Virgins, that book.
Yep.
You know, she narrates the Gukurahundi scenes there in a poetic way. It's so beautiful as to be devastating. So that's where it came from. And to be honest, I think being away from home helped. So when I started this book in the South, and then when I got to Iowa, because I was just there to write, for me, I just took the work. I just felt like I'm just going to just write what I feel I should with freedom. Like, I'm just going to go anywhere and see what happens.
That's amazing. That is amazing. Yeah. We talked a little bit about this earlier when we were making our way here and about some of the scenes that you write about in your book. And it's interesting because, you know, you talk about the feelings that you felt when you're writing. We feel that when we are reading. So we get that. We get the anxiety, what's going to happen next. We get the fear, you know, Uti, the kids who are standing there, who are watching all these atrocities being committed. But some of the scenes are like so graphic, you know. You talk about women being abused, raped, killed, you know. I think for me, it was the slashing of, you know, that woman who was pregnant and the child coming out. I was just like, you describe these scenes with such, I can almost, you know, I think I said this earlier, it's like I feel like I'm there. You know, you've taken me there. It's easier for me because I can then, like, I can, after reading that scene, I can put that book to my chest and be like, phew, you know, I just need a minute. But how did you look after yourself, like, in that space when you are sharing these stories?
Just so powerful. That's it. You guys are just doing the things. You're asking the questions. and so for the graphic scenes, what also inspired the graphicness is because I was tired of hearing discussions about the genocide where people didn't know what they're talking about. We know, but to know as in, do you know the implications? So for me, it was really, when you say you feel it, then I know my job was done as an author, because I'm hoping the reader, you'll feel it, then it might change how we discuss this thing as if it's some small thing that we should get over. But the other, I took the book to therapy, as I was telling you. I found myself in therapy in the US for all sorts of reasons. Partly because of Zim trauma, which is an interesting thing we can talk about another time.
That's
I found myself in the psych ward, crazy stuff when I got, both in South Africa and the US, and always it was led back to Zimbabwe, and I was just like, this is crazy. But with our mental health crisis in Zim, that's something else. But So I took the book to therapy. I went to therapy twice a week during the writing of this book, and it turned into, among other things, always talking about this book. And I'm grateful to my therapist. She was a white American, so it was interesting. I was also teaching about my history and also talking through these scenes. Because initially I rushed through these. I didn't write these scenes the first time. I would rush through them. Then I was encouraged by fellow writers and writing instructors that, you know, for the reader to feel this, you need to feel it. If you can't feel it, if you can't slow down, the reader will also. So thank you for that question. Yeah. No. Therapy was necessary.
Right.
Yeah.
And what do you think, like, what are your thoughts on the importance of national apologies? In our last episode, we looked at how Australia, how Belgium have issued national apologies to certain groups. Like, what do you think, and how do you feel that would work in
Zimbabwe? There's so much power. You were saying there's so much power in national apology. You know, I was in Oxford last week, and there's a professor who's been working on Matabeleland from the 90s. And she was saying the interesting thing is she doesn't understand what people mean when they say they don't know about Gukurahundi. Says the information, it's all there. People know. We know, but what's lacking? And when people say they don't know is the official, people desire official recognition. So there's power when you talk about, I'm thinking about that a national apology makes it official. And I think it makes people feel like it's now okay to address, right, what happened. If it's now also, it's being seen. And it's also, I think, part of that culture of how do you make Matabeleland feel like we're part of Zimbabwe? It's that thing of a lack of apology means a lack of being recognized, a lack of your issues, what matters to you being brought into the national dialogue. Right. Now in Zim, of course, we know it's problematic because how can you have your cake and eat it? Who
will apologize?
Yes, who will apologize? And as Nat was saying at the beginning, what are you apologizing for? It is so difficult.
It's ownership.
Yeah. And I think it's interesting. So I guess for me, this is kind of like a not even a question, a reflection on my part, that you were saying that there's someone who's been working on this, and you know, you know, that they found it interesting that people don't even know.
Jocelyn Alexander, just so she knows I've credited her ideas to her.
I think I think we shouldn't go over this. I think every chance we get, we should tell people what Gukurahundi is.
Oh, wow. Right? Powerful.
Right. So even if you look at the meaning of Gukurahundi, right? It means the early rain which washes away the chaff before the spring rains.
Yeah.
Whew. That's what Gukurahundi means. And in practice, like, Gukurahundi was a genocide. Carried out by the Zimbabwean government in the early 80s, which predominantly impacted people from Matabeleland and some people from Manicaland. And there are reports, you know, which detail, you know, just roughly how many people were killed, numbers from 20,000, you know, to other thousands, right? And this is our history. So in essence, what we have, right? So you had post-colonization in the 1980s. I think it's really important for us to talk about this one. So what you had is 1980, we get independence, right? But I think sort of going back to then and hearing the stories, right? You had, we talked about this yesterday.
Yes.
Where, you know, you had Zebra Forces, which are the arm for the ZAPU, and ZANLA, arm for ZANU, for ZAN, right? And then in 1980, you know, we have Mugabe, who was relatively an unknown then, right? People knew Joshua Nkomo and other players, right? Then what you have is, post that escape, Mugabe is president, you know, ZANLA, Zebra Forces, you know, tooled down arms, were one big happy family, Zimbabwe, right? What did not happen is there was never an integration exercise or sort of like nation building exercise or an awareness of, you know what, you know, they're people who fought, whose language is fighting. Right? So, and you're simply asking them to first of all accept this new leader, like it's all not there, right? And then you sort of have a scenario where, you know, there isn't a, it's kind of like, and again, this is why it's so important for us to know our history.
Yes.
Because we have a history of putting lipstick on a pig from the 80s up even till now. We cover things.
Speak it. Never
addressing it.
Yes. Right? That's
so then what happens, right, is you sort of have that, and then you have zebra forces, a lot of them who fought, who were a bit older. And then now when it comes to getting, you know, the seniority in the barracks and stuff like that, there are all these Zandla forces, like young people maybe who didn't even fight, right? Who are being put in there. There's that internal, you know, wrangling between them, right? Then we have, so we talk about Ndumbane, right?
Yeah, Ndumbane uprising.
Which was kind of, but then there's Ndumbane 1 and Ndumbane 2, right? And I think there's a distinction that needs to be made with that in the sense that, like, you know, initially, I think zebra forces were sort of unhappy with how everything was going, understandably, right? And then as we've seen in our history, then heavy-handed response from what?
From you say heavy-handed.
Yeah, from the government.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
And that whole Ndumbane history, which I would really encourage people to look at, is very reminiscent of what happened post-elections in 2018.
Oh, my God.
But the reason there was a repetition is because we don't know that history. We don't understand it. Where the narrative was like, oh, the opposition forces are doing this. This so is what cliche, they did too. So if people don't understand ZAPU history, I think until we understand ZAPU history, we will not understand what is happening in Zimbabwe now, right?
That makes sense.
And I think what I wanted to say is that's why history is so important. I guess what I've been reflecting on, and I'm writing an article on this, and it won't let me go out, I'm hoping I'll be able to put it out, is the role of what I call the generation removed.
Us.
Which is us.
It's so interesting, the importance of history when you're talking, and I love how you framed it, Uchi, the government, because when I was in Oxford, there was this young, this young girl, 24, Shona, and she says to me, oh, I have your book. I've been afraid to read it because I'm so ashamed of what we as the Shona did. You know, I was like, oh. That's the problem. We were not clear. And then, of course, there's what happened in the narrative. We can deal with the two, right? The current Shona's response to what's happening, but also what happened. That confusion of not knowing and understanding that history is causing a lot of damage currently in how we're talking about this. And people, yeah. So and she's so young. It made me, she was looking down and I felt my heart breaking. Which this is one of the problems. We don't have a clear, specific understanding. It's been denied us what really happened. It can only enlighten us.
And that's the thing. And that's why, so when I think about the generation removed, and our role, so you've done House of Stone, right? Which is one, right? There is a lot of discussion and chat online. That's great. However, it is chatter. I think, how do we move the dial? Because what we have is, we've talked about the importance of an acknowledgement, of government acknowledging, right? Is it allows people not to even debate that the event happened, right?
To deny.
And then I think another thing, you know, we talked about apologies and stuff like that, but us, this generation removed, I think we have to realize where we are literally the gap. Because we can speak, we can speak for our parents and grandparents because they can't, because they were too close to the trauma and they were silenced. But we have the agency to speak. Another thing that uniquely impacts us as Zimbabweans is that our children, right, are probably not going to be born in Zimbabwe. Right? Or whatever. So their experience will be removed, will be further removed. So if we don't fix this as this generation, where first of all, we go beyond it being a debate. Mm-hmm. So like I was saying, that's why I love what you do, do with House of Stone, because we're having an international dialogue about it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's almost like, you know what?
Mm.
Screw whoever in Zim that is denying
this.
We are having an international discussion about it.
Yeah.
So it's like, what more? Even this episode of the podcast is history.
It's history. I'm getting goosebumps.
So we have to be careful how we're doing it.
Mm.
It is history. So I think everything that we're doing as this generation removed is history.
And I love that we're actually having this discussion on the back of your book, you know?
Mm.
And this is what, you know, you're talking about the history and there is a certain history that we have been taught.
Yes.
That is far removed from
what
really happened.
Mm.
And I think from the back of your book, people will start looking up, who is Queen Lozikeye?
That is the hope.
Mm. What actually happened during Gukurahundi? Mm. And I think what you're saying, Nat, is also quite powerful in that we are the generation that bridging the gap. Because you know what? Another thing that I got from your book is, I remember when Uncle Fanny is telling Uzamani about what happened and about how he came to being and how he has a physical, you know, he starts shaking, you know, as he's telling that story.
Mm.
And I think we can feel what, you know, what they went through, but having that element of not actually having gone through it. So it's being that voice. So I think that is actually quite key as well. And I think it's something that is powerful that will actually help to shape the future in that being, that will be the voices for people who are unable to speak, who are silenced.
Yeah. And it just reminds me of something. We touched on shadows, right?
It's so beautiful.
You know, your previous book.
Mm.
And like Humpo, we see that he's an artist, he's a visual artist and stuff like that, right?
Mm.
And when he goes back to Zim, he's charged with offending the
that still exists. That's stupid.
It reminded
law.
Me of our friend Owen Masego.
Owen Masego.
Right. So those of you who don't know, Owen Masego he's a visual painter, he's an artist.
Mm. Outspoken.
Who previously had a collection of paintings which were, you know, showing Gukurahundi. That was inspiration behind it. And at the time at the National Art Gallery in Bulawayo, before Jose's time, right? The paintings were taken down he was taken to court and everything, right?
Mm.
I guess two questions.
Mm.
Poor story, was that, was there a correlation with Owen Masego? It was totally
so
different?
Interesting. No, it was inspired by those events.
Wow.
Because
right.
he does his, though his is not Gukurahundi, right? But it's against the contemporary.
Yeah.
It does take place outside the National Gallery.
Yeah. Mm. And then it takes me to the point of Uti, how do we move the conversation forward? Which is why you need an acknowledgement. Because if you don't have an acknowledgement, when you do things like that, then your stuff can be taken.
Yes.
So how is another Owen Masego or whatever? So what, if someone, if this, say, if Mnangagwa or the National Peace, whatever, if they were to be like, we would like your expertise, what should we do? What would you say? Like, how can we take this?
Go about the national apology.
Mm.
You know, it's a hard one because we're asking the perpetrators to
exactly.
But since we can't, you know, we don't want a polarized situation.
Yes.
Mm.
I really think if a national apology were to be put forth, even if it's not perfect, it's really, it opens up space.
Yes.
Because what you've just said, I think it's enough because there's so many players, and I love what you say about our generation. Little. Individually doing things, they gain power and they move forward.
Mm.
But I think what's lacking in Zim, and you've just brought up Owen Masego,
you've
brought up this podcast, you've brought up the book, and there are many other things happening in
Ozenzele.
Yeah, Ozenzele, Tandeng. Yeah. There are people who are already and have already been doing this work for years.
Mm.
A national apology, I think, would allow, if it's genuine, just allow people, therefore, to come forth and do the work they need to do openly.
Mm.
I don't know if a national apology from someone like Mnangagwa could lead to that, because there's still also tensions as to, because when I heard that Gukurahundi's open for debate, oh my god. My first thing was, does this mean Owen Masego can, because I'd really love to see that exhibition. I'm like, does this mean he can go and put up that exhibition again? Because we need that. We need that.
Yeah. And sorry. No, sorry. Oh my god, you've just made a really good point on that, because we've seen examples of Epalakwe where people are trying to commemorate and then they're stopped. But if we had a national apology, you could have the ability to memorialize as you wish.
Yes.
That's the thing. It's like, apologize, acknowledge. We will do the as rest. We as we see fit to memorialize this event. You give us the agency and the autonomy to do so.
Which is what we won't get, though, I'm sure. Because I feel like these guys want to control the process.
Yeah.
They really want to control everything.
But again, which is why we sort of have to be creative in how we're thinking. I did want to sort of say, I know the time, but I did want to be, I did want to say, Wuti, again, that's why it's important. That's why I said we should describe like what Gukurahundi is for people who don't know. Because there are people who may be listening who don't know. So we should never just gloss over it and say the genocide.
At every point, concentration camps.
And another point which I wanted to sort of say is I saw you were at the Harvard Symposium.
We loved
like
it.
some months back.
I wish there was a camera.
So you should have seen her reaction.
So
guys.
Basically, Novuyo and quite a number of Zimbabwean authors who I remember, I think, was Panache
Chigumadzi.
Yeah. There was Rain Jovu. Yeah. Mm. There was the guy who does the
archives. Jose Chikowero, he's a historian. Mm. Brilliant guy. And Tinashe Mushakavanu.
Yes. So it was such a great discussion about Zim and everything. Ray. What is this book? What's Ray's book?
Please tell me about the crocodile.
In the jaws of the crocodile, right? So basically, Ray Novu in his book, one of the things that he says, right? No, let's say
he's in the jaws of the crocodile.
One of the things
he was in the jaws of the crocodile.
One of the things that Ray said was, because he had an interview with Mnangagwa, and he's like, oh, you know, when Mnangagwa came, he found it so hard to believe that this was the man that was, you know, implicated.
He was so charming.
Yeah, he was so charming. Like he used language that almost sort of diminishes, you know, the role that
even
he plays,
almost,
right?
It does.
Yeah. And then Novuyo, that's what I mean. We already know Novuyo does not suffer any fools whatsoever. So Novuyo called out Ray.
She called it out.
At the thing, and I was like, yes, you know what? It's so important to call out like any inaccuracy, right?
Mm.
But what I wanted to know, Aj, not a profound question, but what I wanted to know is afterwards, Aj, after it all wrapped up, Aj, said Hamba for coffee, for what? Did you guys just leave Ray on his own? What happened? Like what happened after Boston? Ray was hambela a hotel room.
Like Lenzan said, because they must host you.
Y'all are crazy as well. But I guess this is why it's a podcast, because y'all want to know behind the scenes.
Yes.
No. We all went for dinner. Mm. And, you know, Ray tried to explain the process of the book and some of the challenges of crafting the book, you know. So we all went to eat.
Mm-hmm. Together, yeah.
You know, and... No, really.
Are you and Ray cool?
Okay, we're moving on.
Okay, so
we are, I think, as people, but you know.
Can Ray redeem himself?
Hey, that book. That book has serious flaws. It's not an intellectual work, even though it's touted as one. There's many problems. If it had been placed as a James Bond fake, you know, read, it's fine. But it was really placed as something serious when it is not. There's so many problems with that book. And I speak as someone who loves knowledge and loves the truth. And Ray's talking about serious national matters issues, there. You can't play around, flavorize that shit. You need to be, you know... It's an insult to the type of work that we're trying to do. Mm. It's also placing. The publisher should just be honest. A light read, have some laughs, move on.
Oh my God.
I love it.
A light read.
It.
So I think...
But I respect Ray as a journalist. I don't know about as a writer of the book.
Right. Novuyo, could you do us the honor and just read an excerpt from your book, please? Like just something that you, maybe something that you really enjoyed putting together, or you know, just whatever you fancy.
So something a bit light.
Yeah,
because there are a couple of light things here.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Let's have some fun. So this is at the beginning of the book, and it includes Uthandi.
Yes. I love Tandy.
I love Tandy too. All right. I'm opening. Ah. So here, Abednego, the surrogate father, it's 1970s Rhodesia. He's walking around. He sees this beautiful woman walking in town. Imagine country boy, first time in town. He follows her, and it's Tandy. And now he's asked her out on a date.
Mm-hmm.
And so now they're going on the date. Saturday arrived, and my surrogate father, Abednego, found himself standing outside Tikitai at the appointed hour, 2 p.m. sharp, an arm wrapped around the parking meter, the other cocked on his hip, his pompadour conch flourishing up and away from his face. Indeed, at first, when Tandy emerged, dressed in a long, backless floral sundress, and in the company of not one, but two young men, one of them white, she almost didn't recognize him. She stood there appraising him. And then, just as a smile began to spread across Abednego's face, she threw back her head and laughed. It turned out that he didn't look like a rocking and rolling star. And what was worse, the date was between him and Tandy and the two young men. Frankie, whose face ripened under Abednego's glare, and Mvelapi, who, sniggering, kept calling Abednego a Mary Andrew. Abednego wanted to grab Tandy as they piled into Frankie's sky-blue Ford Anglia and shout, "What kind of date is this? Who are these people? Is it because I don't have a car?" But he just got in, Tandy settling in the front seat with Frankie, leaving him to sulk and Velapi in the back.
Wow.
I'll stop there.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Wow, ladies. Guys.
Just to kind of end this section. So, what books would you recommend?
Yeah, we have a little.
What are you reading at the moment? And
yeah. Novuyo recommends.
Yo, I've just been reading The Old Drift by Namwali Sepal. If you like fat books on history, it's like 700 pages. This is Zambian history. Okay. It's also world history. Takes place also in Italy and America. For a nice light read, have you guys heard of My Sister the Serial Killer?
No.
Oh, it's a Nigerian thriller. This sister who has a passion for killing her lovers. You're going to love that.
Wow. Okay.
It's a brilliant read.
Okay.
And then, oh man, Toni Morrison. I'm reading. Mm-hmm. So it's more like your more heavy, serious read.
Yeah.
I'm reading Toni Morrison's Jazz. It's a beautiful, beautiful book.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think I'll leave you with those three. So we have Epic, Namwali Sepal. Nice, light, fun read. Mm-hmm. My Sister, the Serial Killer.
Yeah.
Then a more historical, in depth read, Toni Morrison's Jazz.
And Xolie, what book would you recommend?
For 100%, I would recommend for people to read House of Stone.
Oh.
100%. Like, you know, this book. I don't know if during this pod you have just grasped how much feeling and emotion is in this book. It takes you to different places, and you know it's something that, and it's not only it's not only just fiction. It's also a history, as you're saying. It's you learning as you with each page, and I promise you, it's really an amazing book.
Yeah,
I have loved it.
Thank you so much. Thank guys, you know it. What? I love this conversation. I've loved being a part of it. I can't wait to hear it. I can't wait for the world to hear it. Thank you, Novuyo, for your time, for being with us here. Exactly. And before we kind of, you know, we're going to wind down. We normally do, like, we've been talking heavy things, you know.
Yes.
We're going to do a little bit of music. So,
are you going to sing?
No.
Have you heard this one time, Umbululu?
So,
she can sing.
So Miss Tandy won on Twitter the other day. She was like, "Oh, guys, can you please play any sort of Yvonne Chaka Chaka song?"
Oh, nice.
Right? So yeah. So
like, yes, we make for you.
This
we
one is for you.
Yes.
Yes, Umkombo Ti.
When Mashamin, whoop Umkombo Ti. When my time
in,
whoop um combo chi.
Yes.
When my time in,
whoop um combo chi. Yes, this is my bit.
I love her smile. We've won.
Auntie.
Let's
have it. Every day to make my beer. Umkhonkothi. Wake up early. Every morning. To please my people. With African beer.
Umkhonkothi. Umkhonkothi. Umkhonkothi.
It's African beer. We're mashed up.
And then Novuyo, this one is for you. You asked for this one.
20.
Hey. But I'm boy. Hey.
Slay ladies.
Hey,
in the studio.
Hey. Yes, so.
Champagne. Unat says, Charlie, get down in the house. Ladies and gentlemen. Musisa came to Bulawayo in December last year. Oh my God.
And fire. Did you go?
Of course. Ngani pambile stage ni ngichaya e get down and zimabo.
Hey.
Okay. Hey. What do you know about this?
Ah, ah. This is Gomale.
Manilo.
Ah, la mayas.
You were wrong on that.
Someone requested it. I'm looking at God.
Oh, I know the song. I know the song.
This is like back in the day, man.
I'm going to mbulawa ye no nga yazingo, man.
About this one.
Hey.
Yeah.
Can you also dare go by Zama Eli? Zama 90s.
Yeah.
Hey.
Yeah.
Hey.
Mu papa penny lo.
No.
CP
and Zamil
Zabayazi when it gets to Tom Papa Penny. Papa Penny, was it not the Papa Penny? Anyway, never mind.
Tiba. Get down, sister.
Super pal, I know.
Skita funke le.
All right. I think we are wrapping up now.
Wrapping up.
We are getting ready to go.
Indeed.
But Novuyo, any last words? to the people.
It's been such a pleasure. I've had such a lovely afternoon. And thank you so much for this platform. And you guys are doing amazing work. And I look forward to listening to more of your podcast.
And where can people find you? On social media.
With Twitter. We don't call it Novuyo Rosa Tshuma. We want to lose
stress.
I'm going to call it crown. So.
Yes.
All right. So we are going to sign out with this classic. Let's go. Technology, please. Don't jag me, please.
Hey! This is my turn. So much for listening, guys, and please follow us on Twitter. We are at
Girl in Skies.
Instagram, we're at
Girl in Skies.
Facebook, we're at
Girl in Skies Podcast.
Wonderful. So, and also don't forget to rate us on Apple Music.
Yep.
And subscribe, leave a comment. We would appreciate that.
Absolutely. And Xolie, where can people find you on social media?
At Xolie NC.
And I am at Malaika Diva.
Wonderful.
And if you've come to this part of the podcast,
yes,
please make sure you tag at Gellin's Guys and hashtag true love. I need
true love.
True love, baby.
I want
true love.
True love, baby.